there's a lot of questions that still remain about how Andean temperature and snow and rain respond to big changes in the Earth's climate system. We don't have a lot of data from the Andes. We don't have a lot of data from South America, actually, in general. And the farther uphill you move in the mountains, the less and less data we have. It's a really amazing place to be able to learn some fundamental stuff about how the climate system works here. But on top of that, we have this archaeological piece. You know, this is an active, newly discovered archaeological site. If we can piece together that story, I think it'll tell us a lot about how past civilizations have interacted with, you know, potentially very abrupt changes in climate, which kind of helps to inform what we're seeing today. I have a long history with this site. I came here as an undergrad. I was a junior, and I was studying these little tiny itty-bitty frogs that are living in this whole watershed. This was really my introduction to climate change, looking at glaciers that had obviously melted quite a bit, and thinking about how ecosystems respond to that was really fascinating. I went on to do lots of other things after college, but always in the back of my mind was thinking about this watershed and thinking, man, that lake probably has some really cool stories to tell. So 15 years later, here I am. The work that I do pretty much everywhere follows themes of trying to figure out why precipitation changes over any particular time scale. So here, even though we're high up in the Andes and we're on the western side of South America, a lot of the moisture that is currently starting to fall right now as snow is actually coming from the Atlantic, and it traverses the Amazon basin, and then it gets orographically lifted up the mountainside and then comes down as snowfall here. It might seem like the Atlantic Ocean is really, really far away, but this is a really huge connected system. In order to do this project right, this time around, this field expedition, we need a serious boat with a serious motor. We started planning this a long, long, long time ago.
Just the process of getting to the field site is a difficult one and filled with pitfalls. You know, so many things can go wrong before we even get up here. Our entire team has to arrive several days prior so they can begin the acclimatization process. Cusco lies at just under 4,000 meters or so. During that time, we're also gathering supplies and other equipment that we need to ensure our success up here.
I consider it a small miracle that we all arrived, the motor arrived, the boat arrived, everything kind of got there. We tested the boat. We blew it up in the courtyard of our hotel where we were staying, and they were very kind to accommodate that. Finally, it was the day to leave. We got up here, also a small miracle that we got up here at all, and finally made it. Lo and behold, it has snowed every single day since we got here.
This is a hard place to work. It's high in elevation. The weather is variable. And so when we need to work up here, you know, we have to do it efficiently. An important piece of that also is doing it in a multidisciplinary fashion. These questions can't be answered in a vacuum. There's so many things going on in this ecosystem. It's so complex, from climate change to just the ecosystem function itself and the cultural piece and how all of those interact together. Can really tell us a lot about the Andes, tropical mountain ranges, climate change in general.
One of the best sources of information as archaeologists working in these types of environments are the local populations who are perpetuating in many ways the lifestyle that we're looking to investigate in the past. There's a whole way of life that has developed around this type of environment that's really intriguing to me. How do you survive marginal oxygen saturation? How do you survive at temperatures that fluctuate more during the day than they do during the year? It's obviously resource scarce. The thing that draws me to the area is the pastoralism. So this very intimate relationship between humans and their animals, so llamas and alpacas, and the complete reliance of one species on the other, essentially, in terms of everything that they need. Both the non-food resources and the food resources come from these animals. You're subject to nature here, so you don't get to call the shots, which explains a lot about how people see the environment here. The mountaintops are sacred, the lake is sacred, the wind is sacred. So all of these elements are basically constricting human actions in this environment. Bronwyn Connickeve, her interest is in sort of the development of the lake and when lake levels rose and fell and how that reflects paleoclimate, which sort of ties really nicely into what we're working on in terms of seeing how people interact with marginal environments, because any climate change here, the effects would be amplified on how people interact with the environment.
Mi nombre es Gomer Sindu Crispín Condor y somos natural de Ocongate. Las comunidades siempre están relacionadas con los apos. Siempre es la vida para ellos. Es muy importante. A la creencia de nuestros abuelos, de eso dependía de que el ser humano puede salir adelante en sus animales, en su producción de cultivos. Lo tenemos ahí hasta ahora también, ¿no? Pero aunque la mayoría ya poco a poco va perdiendo, pero...
Their entire kind of ritual tradition of setting time throughout the year has been upended. And it means that their animals are dying off because they can't get them to pasture. It means that the snow covers the pasture and they can't feed them anymore. The freezing episodes become more extreme. And then the rains start setting in times when it's not supposed to, which means that they can't farm and cultivate their crops in the way that they're used to. So they've developed a way of living here. And that way is no longer sustainable for them.
One of the ways that we try to understand how the Andes respond to climate change is to think about the modern climate, but also think about past changes in climate. So if we know periods of time where Earth's climate has warmed or it's cooled, we can look at the way that certain watersheds have responded. What we can expect to see in a sediment core is essentially an integration of stuff washing in off the landscape or blowing in off the landscape and getting preserved on the lake floor through time. I mean, usually you take your coring device, you pitch it off the side of the boat, and kind of hope for the best. In this case, we really had to work with a diver who was familiar with the area.
You know, we know there are artifacts down there. We know there are other cultural features, and so I need to be able to clear that site to make sure, you know, we're not going to damage anything important.
We have all of these archaeological features that are submerged on the lake floor right now. So they weren't built on the lake floor. They were sitting out there on the landscape, and the lake level rose. So my big question is, why did that happen? When did that happen? How quickly did it happen? How is that connected to some of these larger scale processes that we know are really important here in South America?
In sediment coring, usually we want something that has had deposition of sediment continuously with no break in time in order to do paleoclimate reconstruction.
All right, we will wait until you're ready to get our dry suits on, because once we get those on, the clock is ticking, because we're getting very hot. Also, once we get in the water, what's going to limit us here is not the air, because we're so shallow, but it's going to be the thermal capacity. So. The things that make diving here difficult, water here hovers around 5 degrees Celsius, around 42 degrees Fahrenheit. And then you deal with the decompression issues of diving at altitude. It turns out that diving at this altitude is all experimental. There's no human data on it. High altitude tables go to 12,000 feet. We're sitting at 16,000 feet right here. Fortunately, most of the work we do here are shallow depths, so we try to keep our diving at 20 feet and above. We don't go below that.
Over there? Okay, let's head that away. There's no like scuba sign for take a sediment core. Got it?
Mm-hmm.
What we're trying to get with this is the transition between what used to be a beach and what is now under the lake. And so what we get here is a whole lot of essentially just beach sand. And at the very, very top is what we would more normally see on the floor of a lake. We have sort of classic lake sediment, some little plants growing on the very surface there. That probably represents a transition between a period of time where the surface was exposed and then it was covered by water.
So the cores that we're getting right now, I think will give us some really good information about how this particular watershed and this central Andes have changed as the climate has warmed across the globe. So we're really looking at the last couple hundred years. Because I'm a geologist by training, I of course want to go back even further in time.
We are getting ready to go out and collect some sediment cores that are for paleoclimate and paleoenvironmental reconstruction. So it's different from what we were doing before. What I'm really interested in is tracking that lake level rise through time, figuring out when it happened, how long it took. Was it some big catastrophic event? Did it take a couple hundred years? And for that, we really need these longer cores. So we haven't had as much luck with that so far. The lake has a lot of clay, and clay is really hard to core through with the type of equipment that we have.
So Lake Sabina Cocha is really big, which is what we want. We want a big watershed integrating a really large surface area, but the downside of that is that it's really deep. So that means the types of coring devices that we could bring up here just rely on their own weight, essentially, to settle into the sediments. And we're dropping that core from 120 feet, something like that. When you're dropping essentially a plastic tube through the water column, I mean, a lot can go wrong, and a lot did go wrong.
Oh, I think there's something in it.
Oh man, we had to fight for that. We finally got a car. Yeah, we're pretty deep. We're at about 130 feet right now. We know that we have the top intact. So this is the most recent sedimentation. And then this goes back and back further in time.
I've had my eye on this site for a long time for climate reasons. There's archaeologists who have been looking at this site and thinking, wow, that's a really cool place. And now we're coming up with ideas together, and it's very synergistic. We're really in sync when it comes to thinking about these really cool questions that we wouldn't be able to answer just on our own. This next couple of years, I think we'll be able to get a really good sense for how the lake and its watershed have changed in the last few hundred years, if not 5 or even 10,000 years.